Morning, and thank you for joining us. I'm Robert Perkins, a content and media strategist with Caltech's Office of Strategic Communications. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the Conversations on Sustainability. The series is hosted by the Caltech Science Exchange and gives us a chance to hear from scientists and engineers who are working on the cutting edge of research and technology that can mitigate the effects of climate change and help us to build a more sustainable future. I'm joined today by Harry Atwater, Caltech's Howard Hughes Professor of Applied Physics and Materials Science, and the Otis Booth Leadership Chair of the Division of Engineering and Applied Science. Dr. Atwater is also a lead researcher on the Space Solar Power Project, which plans to put solar panels into space to beam power back to Earth. And he's the director of the Liquid Sunlight Alliance, or LISA, which seeks to help convert sunlight into fuels. Dr. Atwater, thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Robert. Yeah, thank you.
Can we start with just a little bit of background? Would you mind providing a brief overview of the history of solar power? Tell us a little bit about how it works.
Well, photovoltaic cells were invented at Bell Laboratories in 1954 in response to the need to power the first satellites, actually, that were launched by the United States. And they remained a sort of boutique technology for a long time. And when I was a graduate student in the 1980s, the world had only 1 megawatt of total installed solar power. That's only, it's a little less than we have installed here on the Caltech campus. And of course, in the intervening years, what happened was we saw the telltale signs of exponential growth. And that's one of the kind of exciting things about technology is that change is exponential. And with an exponential curve, you don't notice it growing for a while, but it keeps doubling and doubling and doubling. And around the early 2000s, suddenly the capacity and the technology growth got to the point where we ran out of silicon temporarily for solar cells. And the reason was because the manufacturing capacity for solar photovoltaics actually exceeded the supply of silicon, which before that time had been used only for microelectronics. And so at that point, the photovoltaics industry had to develop its own supply of silicon. It did so, and that enabled the continued exponential growth. And that exponential growth, by the way, was accompanied by an exponential reduction in cost. It's sort of a Moore's law curve, not quite as many as orders of magnitude as the actual Moore's law for microelectronics, instead of 6 or 7 orders of magnitude, but between 2 and 3 orders of magnitude in price, about a factor of 500 reduction since I was a graduate student in cost. And today we're at the hundreds of gigawatt scale. By next year, sometime the world will actually see its first terawatt of installed solar photovoltaic power. So that's sort of a thumbnail sketch of the history.
That's fantastic. So the Biden administration just announced a plan to produce almost half of the nation's power from solar by 2050. Do you think that's possible? And if so, what technological advances do you think would be needed to get us there?
Well, so I think that it's possible, but it requires a coordinated and concerted effort all the way across the innovation chain from R&D all the way to deployment and policy. There's no one thing that would allow us to achieve it. There is some concern that today's technology for silicon photovoltaics might not be able to scale fast enough. And that is providing the impetus for alternative solar photovoltaics that are currently in R&D that could have a lower capital cost for manufacturing. So it's not clear whether or not that's true. Historically, the silicon photovoltaics business has done a very good job of cost reduction. But there may be other technologies on the horizon, thin film materials such as the lead halide perovskites and other thin film materials that could further dramatically reduce the materials utilization and the capital costs. So I think it's going to require a multidisciplinary, multi-pronged effort where policy, technology development, manufacturing, innovation, installation are all going to have to play a role.
I understand if I go buy a solar panel right now, it's probably going to be one of the silicon ones. How long before we could buy one from one of these alternative materials?
Well, you can actually do that today, not as a consumer, but for example, the leading source of photovoltaic panels that is manufactured within the United States is a thin film panel. It comes from the company called First Solar that manufactures thin film photovoltaics at a very low cost and a very innovative non-silicon process. So there are other materials on the horizon, other thin film materials. The thing that at this point that any disruptive material that would come in and seek to overtake silicon or the thin film materials that First Solar is working with cadmium telluride would have to have this a cost and a durability that is superior to the incumbent. And durability is a really big concern because unlike the conventional energy business where you consume fuel, in renewable energy, like in solar photovoltaics, you pay a big upfront capital investment, or it's a significantly declining capital investment, but you pay all the capital investment upfront, and then you basically amortize that capital over time. And the longer time period over which you can amortize it, the lower the cost of the power generated is.
When we're talking about these thin film technologies, how thin are we talking about?
So we're talking about films that are less than an optical wavelength thick. We actually have materials that are so absorbing of sunlight that we can use materials of order of a micron thick. It's quite remarkable. The prospect for actually working with thin film cells that would have significantly reduced materials utilization is quite interesting. That's quite different from silicon. Silicon, because of its physical properties, it's known as an indirect band gap semiconductor. It's a relatively weak absorber of light. You need about 180 microns of silicon to really make an efficient solar cell, but less than one micron of some of these other thin film materials.
You know, along those lines, what new technologies or emerging technologies in the solar industry are you most excited about right now?
Well, so I guess I would say in the industry, probably the thing that is most exciting are the emergence, for example, of bifacial photovoltaic modules. These are photovoltaic modules that can be illuminated from both sides. They're now available in the marketplace. And if you install them in a fashion that they get some reflected light from the surface of the Earth, from the albedo of the Earth, you can actually exceed the sort of one-sided power conversion efficiency in a solar panel that doesn't have, the manufacturing and technology attributes otherwise are not significantly different from an ordinary conventional silicon panel. I would say that the things that I'm most excited about seeing come out of, say, research and development will be things like the thin film materials that are now challenging silicon in efficiency. We have, historically, we've been able to make thin film materials that were low cost and low efficiency, and now we're seeing that there are thin film materials that are low cost and high efficiency. What remains to be proven in the marketplace is their durability, that they can last as long as your roof does, say, for 30 years. So that's going to be the key challenge that will enable them to get out into the marketplace.
So what prevents us from just having a whole power grid that's all solar?
Well, so one of the things that about solar energy is that it's an instant on and instant off technology, in the sense that if you remove the light source, then the power generation goes away. So solar really produces a so-called dispatchable, in other words, a predictably available source of electricity, such that you could plug your laptop, like I've done, into the wall back here, and not have to guess as to whether the power is going to come out. That's true when you can make solar power be dispatchable by combining it with a form of electricity storage. That could be battery storage. It could also be chemical energy storage, and that's quite an interesting option. Chemical energy storage, we're very familiar with, we use every day to fuel transportation and air, aviation and our automotive fleet, although that's, rapidly electrifying. But chemical energy storage is sort of indefinite energy storage. Nowadays, for example, quite notably, LA County is commissioning the design and construction of a solar, utility scale solar plus storage capability in northern LA County that will feed the Los Angeles region that combines solar generation plus 4 to 6 hours of storage using batteries. So you could generate 4 to 6 hours or maybe even up to 24 hours worth of storage. What would be very difficult to do with batteries would be to generate seasonal storage going from one season, say from winter to summer. In many parts of the world, that's very important because it's pretty dark in the wintertime and very abundantly light in the summertime. And that's where storage options like chemical fuels would come into play that would be very interesting as a means for energy storage, just for solar energy.
You know, and I'm going to use this moment just to plug. We've got a webinar coming up in October that will discuss the future of the energy grid. So, you know, stay tuned if that is something of interest to folks in the audience. Shifting gears a little bit. Even if we could drastically reduce CO2 emissions now, the greenhouse gases that are already in the atmosphere still pose a problem in terms of climate change. Can you talk a little bit about carbon capture and negative emissions technology that could address this?
Yeah, I think this is now beginning to reach the level of widespread, public, at least consciousness raising and some level of understanding that the atmosphere is a reservoir, basically. And since 1750, when we started mining coal and producing steam engines and so forth, we have been pumping carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Some of that carbon dioxide, for example, is absorbed into the ocean, and that's actually acidifying the ocean. The ocean is also a huge reservoir. In fact, most of the carbon in the form of carbon dioxide is actually stored in the ocean, but we have a big component in the atmosphere. And that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, of course, tips the balance of our radiative flux balance between sunlight and cooling of the earth by thermal radiation. It tips it just enough to produce global warming and climate change. So in order to have a world that we regard as being pleasantly livable, we want to not only decarbonize, which would leave us with the same level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that we have now, say 50 years from now, because the rate at which carbon dioxide is, say, resorbed at the air water surface in the oceans is on a longer time scale. So we need technologies for capturing carbon dioxide from the air carbon dioxide capture from the air and from the water, seawater, are technologies that are emerging as being options that we're considering among technologists, among economists, and actually among many large Fortune 500 companies have now pledged to become net zero carbon in their emissions. And if they have some finite emissions, that means they have to have some form of negative emissions or carbon credits to offset that. So to fully restore the atmosphere and the oceans back to pre-anthropogenic times, back to the stage they were in 1750, we need to capture the carbon that we've emitted into the atmosphere and the oceans. And so that will, in fact, become a project that is a very large-scale project for the global society. I often tell people that the size of the negative emissions industry will eventually grow up to be the size of the positive emissions industry. In other words, the entire energy industry as we knew it until a few years ago. So it's going to be a very big business if we're serious about doing it at scale.
So what do we do with that carbon if we capture it? Where does it go?
Well, there are a number of things that we can do. One is that we can sequester it back underground. If you pump CO2 into geological reservoirs, eventually it will there are geological transformations that lead to the formation of carbonate minerals. That happens on a slow time scale, and it happens better in some places than others. Depends on the geology in which CO2 is injected. We can also make products fuels, chemicals, and materials by electrochemical or thermochemical or other kinds of renewable energy-driven transformations of carbon dioxide, essentially going backwards from carbon dioxide to the products that came originally from fossil fuels, like liquid hydrocarbons, oils, paraffins, waxes, carbon-based building materials, where we can sequester carbon.
What's preventing us from doing that right now?
Well, so there, I say there are two things that prevent us from doing it right now. So nothing prevents us from doing it right now. We have technology for doing it. Right now, it's relatively expensive, and it's at a relatively small scale. So the scale at which we're emitting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere is about 44 gigatons per year, about 10 gigatons of carbon or 44 gigatons of CO2. And that's expected to double as, you know, if we didn't otherwise decarbonize, the world's energy use is expected to double in the next 50 years. So we have to plan not only for that amount, but also the amount that would, you know, correspond to the energy use growing. So we have to capture the carbon. And right now, the larger scale capture, which has been done by two companies working in partnership, Climeworks and CarbFix, have managed to capture, you know, a few hundred tons on the kiloton scale. And we need to capture gigatons. So there's a couple of orders of magnitude to go in the carbon capture. And in the electrochemical transformations, we're able to do this at the laboratory scale and at the sort of deployment pre-commercial technology scale. Right now, it's relatively expensive to do this. And so that's something where the technology development and scaling is going to be needed to have this become a very widespread technology.
What technology do you see coming out of the lab right now that excites you for this?
Well, so I would say there are a number of very interesting technologies that have emerged from the basic science part of the lab and gone into what I'll call the development part of the lab. For making hydrogen electrochemically. So hydrogen is very interesting as a base feedstock for many industrial processes. Hydrogen plus carbon monoxide, which would be the simplest way to reduce CO2, for example, leads to all the fuels and specialty and commodity chemicals and carbon-based materials. There are versatile processes like the Fischer-Tropsch reactions that can be used to create a wide variety of carbon-based products once you have hydrogen, say, and carbon monoxide. And actually, it turns out that hydrogen and carbon monoxide are sort of thermoneutral in their generation. So if you have hydrogen, you can reduce CO2 to make carbon monoxide and then use more hydrogen to further reduce it and so forth. So it's quite interesting if you can make hydrogen. So there are a number of processes that are looking very attractive for making hydrogen electrochemically. And then also using solar energy, either indirectly in the form of photovoltaics or directly in the form of photoelectrochemical solar energy generation to directly make hydrogen. And that's actually something we've been doing at Caltech through the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis, which began in 2010, is actually wrapping up this at the end of this week, September 30th. Fortunately, that doesn't mean the end of renewable fuels and fuels from sunlight research at Caltech. It's going to continue on in the form of the Liquid Sunlight Alliance for the next few years as well.
Talk a little bit about the Liquid Sunlight Alliance. What is it and what does it hope to do?
Yeah, so Liquid Sunlight Alliance, or LISA as we like to call it, is dedicated towards going to the next step beyond generation of hydrogen or simple reduced products of carbon dioxide like carbon monoxide, to going all the way to making heavy hydrocarbons, say liquid products that could be used for oils, fuels, industrial products that are made from hydrocarbons and oxygenates. And that requires some scientific elegance and sophistication because it involves transferring many electrons and protons going and essentially knitting up individual carbon atoms into multi-carbon molecules. So for example, jet fuel that we use for powering our airplanes consists of hydrocarbon molecules with a molecular weight distribution between about 7 and 17 carbon molecules. And right now we're down at the stage in most R&D labs of sort of making one or two carbon atoms in a molecule rather than the 7 to 17 range that would be needed for that application, for example.
You talk a little bit also about other veins of research that you and your colleagues are working on in solar power. I'm thinking of the Space Solar Power Project right now.
Yeah. So I want to say a little bit about, you know, what are some of the other ways to make dispatchable solar energy? So as we know, solar energy is intermittent. It's predictably intermittent. It's nighttime every night. And so we got a capacity factor of only about 20%. Or favorably in some places about 25% in a day, meaning the fraction of power you generate over a single 24-hour cycle is about 25% of what it would be if it were noon, all day and all night, for example. But one place where it's noon 24 hours a day is in space, where we don't have the occlusion of solar radiation by the day-night cycle. So the Space Solar Power Project is dedicated to the concept of developing ultralight structures, which can be economically launched from the Earth to provide large-scale power, both, you know, first for space power systems, for spacecraft, and then to produce power for wireless power transfer to the Earth. And that's a really elegant concept where when coming to fruition would be able to produce continuous power 24 hours a day without having storage as an additional cost and technology expense that would be needed. So it's quite an interesting option. The fact that it can also be beamed to many places on Earth means you could actually supply power to places where there is not currently a copper landline utility infrastructure, like a grid. So that could be cause a leapfrog for, you know, emerging and developing parts of the world for power generation.
Where are you at with that right now?
So the Space Solar Power Project is at a very interesting sort of milestone moment where we have developed many of the technologies, the ultralight deployable structures, the wireless power transfer, and the ultralight photovoltaics. And then about the middle of next year, we will have our first demonstration flight on a low Earth orbiting spacecraft of these key technologies, these three key technology areas. I've been joined by the SSPP directors, Sergio Pellegrino and Ali Hajimiri here at Caltech, in a wonderful collaboration over the last few years to create and merge these technologies, to fuse them together into making space solar power, ultralight space solar power technology reality. And we're going to have a really exciting opportunity to test them out next year in space.
So how big is the panel you're putting up in space next year? And will it be able to beam power back to Earth?
So it's going to beam power, but it's going to basically beam power from one part of the spacecraft to the other. We may, for example, if the conditions permit, look for power coming from the spacecraft, for example, using ham radio kind of instrumentation to detect the power. We're looking into some of the logistics of this and whether it'll be possible. The key milestones and the objectives for this first demo are simply to show that these technologies will work in space, not to beam the power to the Earth. If we can do that, that'll be a huge sort of logistic, technical, and frankly, sort of psychological obstacle to overcome to show that the technology is viable in space. So we're going to be doing deployment of ultralight structures, testing photovoltaics, ultralight photovoltaics, some of which have never flown in space before, and the beamed power generation and transmission and reception all on the spacecraft. So if we can show those, then that will give impetus to the next demo two, which will be focusing on an integrated solar power system.
I would imagine there are probably some undergrads and the folks on this call who are wondering, all right, what can I do in these fields? So if you were a budding scientist or engineer interested in tackling renewable energy or climate change, what field or specialty would you look at getting into?
Well, the good news is there's opportunities everywhere you look. So there's no one thing. You know, I'm very excited about solar power. I've always been fascinated by the way light interacts with matter, from fundamental nanoscale light matter interactions all the way up to global, you know, solar power deployment. So for me, that's the area where I've dug in, and that's where my scientific frontier lies. And of course, ultimately, also all energy that we use on Earth is ultimately solar energy, but of course, we transform it in many ways. Another area where there's a lot of excitement is in emerging battery technologies, which could really speed the decarbonization of transportation and maybe even grid scale storage. I think there's huge opportunity in computational and math sciences for all you computer science folks out there, working on a sort of power internet. This is something, for example, my colleagues Stephen Lowe and Adam Weirman are working on in CMS at Caltech. How do you envision, instead of a power transmission grid where we broadcast power, to have something almost like the internet where we packet switch power and make the grid more resilient and bi-directional, where we can accommodate lots of, you know, millions of generation sources as well as loads. Also in the area of electrochemistry and photoelectrochemistry, as I mentioned, generating fuels from sunlight or generating fuels from renewable electricity. Those are, you know, huge options. Those are really rapidly growing fields, and one where Caltech has a significant presence.
You know, these are all exciting technologies, but I also know that every other day you see a news article about just how bad climate change has gotten and how much carbon's in the atmosphere. Are you optimistic that these technologies are going to be scalable and deployable in time to mitigate the effects of climate change?
Yeah, so this is where I have to go back and reset my reference frame back to when I was a graduate student. So I was a grad student, and I had the privilege of working on some early thin film photovoltaic cell development as a graduate student researcher. And as I mentioned at that time, you know, the idea that you could power the world with solar power was a kind of an enthusiastic hope, but nobody had any vision that it would actually come to the scale that it's at. As I mentioned, the entire world's capacity for PV power generation was measured in megawatts when I was a student. And it's grown up to the multi-hundred gigawatt per year photovoltaic production. And as I mentioned, we're going to terawatt scale now. So I think this offers a really powerful lesson, which is, I mentioned earlier, the concept that in technology, change is exponential. We're used to this idea in microelectronics, in other information sciences like storage, optical communication networks, and so forth, that things can grow exponentially. And this is also true for energy technology, where you have innovation, you know, essentially a progress and experience curve that can drive down costs as the volume grows up. And I see no reason that the other renewable energy technologies that we need, carbon capture, electricity storage, and so forth, they all have similar characteristics where you build capital, capital projects, and then they do their work of generating energy or capturing carbon, for example. But I think there can be, you know, exponential progress curves for these technologies as well, because they're fundamentally driven by innovation. So I would say I'm optimistic based on my own lived experience.
Fantastic. All right, if it's all right here, I'd like to switch over and ask a couple questions from the audience. Let's see. So what is the greatest threat to solar technologies adoption?
Greatest threat to solar technology adoption? Let's see, I guess I don't foresee any sort of existential or, you know, ultimately limiting threat. I think now, a few years ago, I would have said public acceptance, you know, the idea that solar energy was actually energy that could be, you know, generated at scale. A lot of people regarded it as this sort of boutique kind of form of energy generation that couldn't generate energy at scale. But what we see actually, you know, regardless of our opinions, is that the people that make sober financial calculations and utilities and so forth, when they have to go to a new form of power generation, they're going to look for the lowest cost option so that they don't have to raise rates for their ratepayers excessively. Of course, they're also very concerned about reliability. You know, they're one of the most conservative industries in terms of reliability, but consistently, time after time, they've been choosing solar power in both in the United States and around the world. It's the fastest growing, you know, it's the largest part of the new electricity installation in the United States right now. So I think at the utility scale, project developers and utility decision makers are making decisions for us. As a consumer, you can also decide if you have rooftop available, you can put solar on your roof. If you do live in an apartment, you can still enjoy the benefits of solar through so-called community solar type projects, where you can essentially own a share of a community generated solar farm and use it in your utility load. So, yeah.
And what about carbon conversion? Is it more effective and environmentally friendly to convert carbon into a fuel than to sequester it?
Yeah, so these are really important questions that are playing out. So I guess one of the questions is what's the duration of the sequestration in each case? So if I make a fuel and I put that fuel back into a fuel tank and I keep it there, it can be sequestered for as long as I'm willing to keep the fuel. Of course, the minute I burn the fuel, then I've released CO2 again, and I created something that's CO2 neutral, which for example, for aviation would be a big development if we could do that, to make net CO2 neutral aviation. All the airlines and aircraft companies are very interested in that. In geologic formations, the uptake and then say the carbonate mineral formation is mineralization, it is variable from one place to another. And there, you know, one of the questions is whether or not that needs to still be resolved is whether we have adequate geological reservoirs to sequester all, you know, suppose we're able to scale the carbon capture to sequester it all underground. So I'm actually optimistic about look forward to seeing applications where we literally embed carbon in our built infrastructure. One of the areas where the world is going to develop, of course, is in, you know, development of urban areas. Urbanization is still a trend in the world. And if we literally embed carbon in building materials like pavement, cement, so forth, there's a tremendous possible reservoir there. Another place is in the soil. So I've been talking about chemical and physical techniques for achieving a circular carbon economy and decarbonization. But there are also biological routes that are very important. For example, in temperate climates, we have a huge carbon reservoir in the soil. And so that's another very important part of the puzzle as well.
See, here's one about space solar power. Wouldn't gathering energy in space and beaming it to Earth result in more solar energy being absorbed by the Earth and therefore create greater global warming?
That's a very interesting question. So if you do a net energy balance, the question is not whether you would generate, or I guess the relevant question to me is whether you have an opportunity to mitigate climate change by providing carbon-free dispatchable power, and whether that would offset any change in the energy balance with the Earth. And so the capacity for generating solar power in space doesn't materially alter the power generation profile for the Earth. The Earth is capable of radiative emission through the atmosphere, provided we don't have a pernicious heat trapping layer. These are important questions to look at, but I think the net energy balance, if you were able to mitigate the heat trapping effects of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere for solar power generated from space, would be in the positive column.
Okay. Let's see. What's the end-of-life management for all these new photovoltaic technologies? Are these things that are going to wind up just being in a landfill, or can they be recycled?
That's a really important question. We don't want to generate P-waste, photovoltaic waste, that's analogous to E-waste that we now are all familiar with. So there, this is something that is one, I would say is something that has now really captured the attention front and center of the solar industry. And there are major projects underway to look at ways to, energy efficiently disassemble photovoltaic panels. It's a big project at NREL aimed at understanding durability and disassembly and life cycle analysis. It's a very standard part of each photovoltaic technology to perform life cycle analysis. Incidentally, there's one technology, as I mentioned, the thin film technology that First Solar uses, where they have done extensive life cycle analysis and actually, as part of their sale and deployment agreement, agree to remit their panels back and remanufacture them. So as part of their business model. So there is already life cycle planning for the thin film materials. I would say that's a future challenge for silicon photovoltaics, not fully solved yet, but there's a lot underway to, for example, be able to recover and reuse silicon wafers rather than have to return them all the way back to, say, silicon dioxide and then pour a lot of energy into reducing the silicon dioxide again.
So is it easier to recycle these thin film technologies as opposed to the silicon?
In principle, it's easier because the, well, there are several reasons. One, they sort of disassemble more easily and the total material flows are smaller.
Okay. So how does the energy required currently to sequester carbon dioxide compare to the amount of CO2 that is generated when coal or oil was burned to generate that energy?
Well, so the reality is that it takes now, you enjoyed, where we enjoy the benefits of the combustion of fossil fuels and generation of carbon dioxide that goes into the atmosphere in terms of energy services. By the way, about if you use a power plant or a, you know, an engine in your car to burn fuels, some hydrocarbon fuel, a huge amount of that goes into waste heat. So there's a famous diagram called a Sankey diagram. In the United States, the Lawrence Livermore Lab is the keeper of these diagrams that shows that if you look at primary energy generation and then energy use, only a fraction of the primary energy that's generated actually goes into use. Mm. So more energy has to be expended to drive CO2 back to its original primary form of energy storage in hydrocarbons or alcohols or something like that than we got out of it as useful energy services. That's to be sure. So what that means is we're going to have to build effectively an energy infrastructure that takes advantage of this exponential decline in the cost of energy to not only supply the energy we need right now in the form of electricity and other forms of renewable energy, but also to, work backwards and reduce the carbon dioxide that's in our atmosphere and oceans. So that's going to be a project that we're going to have to take on as the global civilization, where we build some infrastructure that's dedicated not to powering our electronics and our cars and our communication systems and our homes, but actually just to undoing the CO2 emissions.
Okay. I've got one here from someone that says, I've seen industrial carbon capture systems in places like Sweden and Iceland. Are these not viable larger scale options?
Yeah, actually, for example, recently in the news, company Climeworks developed a pilot scale demonstration that they staged in Iceland. And so the company itself projects the costs of doing this to be at multi-hundred dollars per ton. Right now, through the form of carbon credits, there are people that are willing to buy carbon dioxide or sequestered carbon at that price. Ultimately, the landscape is going to become more competitive. The number that most policymakers and economists and technologists are kind of shooting for as the number that could really allow us to get to a tipping point in terms of technology scale up is around $100 a ton. If you get to or below $100 a ton, then that's a price that I think people regard as being something that we'd be willing to pay. So in other words, the energy input and the infrastructure scaling that we would need would be, less than the size of the world economy, of course, to do this. Something of the order of, maybe a fraction of the defense budget or something like that to do this. And frankly, I think that's a pretty good investment in the from my perspective, in terms of ensuring future global security.
Fair enough. Let's see. What's the payback time for current solar panels to recoup the energy that was used to make them? The estimates I've seen vary, but seem to center around 11 years. Is that roughly what you're?
Oh, no. There was 11 years ago, maybe 11 years ago, but or 11 years, 11 years ago. But now that number is less than a year. Wow. So a panel has currently a warranted lifetime of between 25 and 30 years. There is actually a large-scale sort of discussion going on in the PV industry. Panels are sufficiently reliable that some of the industry is considering extending the standard warranty to either 40 or 60 years. But in terms of the energy input to make the panel, the payback time is less than a year.
Given the current state of technology, would you recommend somebody to put solar panels on their house now? Or would you say, hold off, there's some really great technology coming just around the corner? What would you do?
Yeah, this reminds me of the debate about personal computers back when I was a grad student, in which case, if you thought about it, you're always better off to wait because you're going to get a better computer next year. And of course, the reality is nobody just waited. They needed a computer now, right? And if you need renewable energy, you need it now. It'll get cheaper. But the cost of solar panel, electricity coming from solar on your roof, if you live in California, is cheaper than buying the electricity from the utility. So it's a good deal.
Excellent. Is there enough land area on Earth to give us all the solar energy we want as a civilization?
Yeah, this is if you think about, what's the appropriate kind of analogy. And in a U.S. context, for example, to provide all of the energy services from solar power in the United States, we would need something of the order of 4 to 6% of the land mass of the United States. So 4 to 6% corresponds to the land that we've already allocated for highways, railroads, utility rights of way, urban areas, and so forth, essentially already developed land. Mm-hmm. So that gives you an idea of the scale. So it's large. And so because solar energy is, it's abundant and ubiquitous and very large scale, but it's a diffuse form of energy. So the land areas are large. So we are now starting to see solar power plants on the kilometer scale. If you drive out to San Luis Obispo County, for example, you can see a kilometer scale solar plant in California. But it's not, so large that it's going to compete for land use with, crop cultivation or, water harvesting and so forth.
Gotcha. And we've got time for just one more question. With interruptions like hurricanes and other adverse weather, what sort of mix of power sources do you feel is optimal? What percentage of fossil fuel, nuclear, renewable?
I'm going to leave that to my computational and math sciences colleagues, because one of the lessons that comes out of the thinking about the power of mathematics, and by the way, as division chair for the Engineering and Applied Science Division, one of my sort of calls to clarion calls is that there's really exciting developments going on in math and computation right now, and we should learn how to take advantage of them. Nowhere is that more true than in thinking about building resilient infrastructure, starting with resilient power networks. So I think it's not so much a matter of thinking about what kind of energy provides more resiliency. I think it's what kind of energy system, namely what kind of network provides energy resiliency, and it's a resilient network. It's something like a power internet. We're familiar with the idea now that the entire internet doesn't go out. If some nodes on the internet go out, your packets get rerouted and so forth. So the vision for the future for resilient networks is to do the same thing for power and other kinds of needed infrastructure.
Excellent. All right. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Atwater, and thanks for everybody for joining us. For more information on research conducted by Dr. Atwater, please visit daedalus.caltech.edu. That's Daedalus, as in the guy whose son Icarus flew too close to the sun. For more on the Space Solar Power Project, visit spacesolar.caltech.edu. For more on LISA, visit Liquid Sunlight Alliance, it's all one word, .org. And the next event in the Conversations on Sustainability series will be coming up on October 18th. when my colleague Emily Velasco will talk to Professors Stephen Lowe and Adam Weirman about a smarter electricity grid. In the meantime, if you're interested in exploring the more science-driven solutions for a warming planet, please check out the Caltech Science Exchange. The site provides trustworthy answers and clear explanations on critical topics in science and technology. And you can find that at scienceexchange, all one word, .caltech.edu. Thank you.